So my name is Brandy Howdige. I work in the CALPADS office. And so I've been developed a great partnership with Sandy and Jeff and all the staff here at Santa Clara County. And we do our data coordinators meetings 4 times a year. They're really well attended. It's a very engaged group. I love coming here. So what I want to do is just sort of give you an overview. But a lot of the stuff you've been hearing, we've been coming at you hard, fast, and constant, right? So I want to be engaging, and I want to tailor it to what you really want to talk about, okay? So in this particular presentation, I talk a lot about special ed collection and some of the stuff that's going on there. The discipline changes that are coming up this year, the reporting changes. So there's changes with discipline and the addition of restraint and seclusion. The changes that we're making for the language instruction programs for English learners and even some non-English learners. So what do you guys want to hear? Because I can go through it all, and we can stay here till 5 o'clock. So how many of you are CALPADS administrators? Okay. And so for those of you what do the rest of you do?
I'm a CALPA director.
Oh, you're a CALPA. That's right. I've seen you before. Assessment and accountability. Okay. What about you? Data analyst. And over here?
Program evaluation.
Okay.
I used to be a CALPA.
I remember you.
No, I work for Head Start preschool.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I miss CALPA.
Well, we miss you too. And your role is?
Me?
Yes.
I work for CALPADS.
Oh, yeah. Why do I not know you? Do I know you?
I know you.
Oh, my gosh. You know what? I hear their voices all the time, but I rarely ever go over to that building, and it literally is maybe, half a mile away.
I probably see you.
You do. You do. You do see me. Okay. So, let's just kind of go through things. I'm not going to bore you with the details of the case Mr. CALPADS transition. The train has officially left the station. Now we are collecting all data for students, including students with disabilities in CALPADS. There is no more case miss. But there is still the two different silos of information at the local level, the special education data system, as well as the student information system. And so right now, we're seeing some of the gaps in those two systems, because now both of those systems are submitting data directly to CALPADS. And the expectation is that they're going to correlate. And that correlation has already been made at the local level. And you guys are probably getting lots of headaches because they're not matching for whatever reason. Okay, so in terms of the program 144 records that you guys have tracked in your student information system. So special education was tracked as a program record in the SIS, but the source of those data was actually the special ed system, right? Whether you say CALPADS or CIRUS here in this county, that piece of information always came from the special education data system, but it was a pain to keep it updated in the student information system. Is it still necessary for you guys to track that in your SIS? The answer is yes. You still need to do it. You still need to maintain those data because you use them locally for other things, right? Your administrators want to be able to log into whatever student information system you use and see how many kids with disabilities there are, or teachers need to see that information, or nurses or counselors, right? There's a whole host of people that still need that information. So it has to be shared. But for state reporting purposes, you will not report that from the student information systems. You will report it from the special education data systems. So any questions or issues that you guys have been having with that? Yes?
I have a question. In general, are you in close contact with the CIS providers? For example, many of us use ARIES.
Yes.
Right? I mean, does ARIES know not to send 144?
Yes. So they do. I will tell you that some of the student information systems vendors are more engaged than others, right? ARIES is actually pretty engaged, but they're all, I think they're becoming increasingly involved in the process, many of the student information system vendors. So yes, most of them know that they should not be sending that up. And most of them find out when their clients are getting errors in CALPADS saying, you can't send this up. and they'll say, well, why are we sending this up in the extract, right? And so vendors are, some of them are more responsive than others. Yes? With a department?
Yes.
How do we know that they're engaging with the department?
Yes.
That is a really good question. How do you know, Lisa? This is Lisa Hayes from CSIS, for those of you that don't know her.
Because the Department of Education hosts vendor calls every 2 weeks, and there are some vendors that are always on the calls,
right.
And there are some vendors that are very active and engaged, and also are very familiar with the clientele and what their issues are when new things are coming up, or
right.
when a new reporting requirement is proposed or has been implemented and people are having difficulty with it. And there are other vendors that don't show up very often.
Right.
And other vendors that don't ask questions, or they don't appear to be as engaged.
Right. So we have, over the last probably 6 months, started tracking which vendors are attending these calls, and they happen every 2 weeks. So anytime we're making any major changes in CALPADS, just so you know, we try to give them like at least a 6 month heads up so that you guys will be ready for it. And they will be prepared for it. So we've been tracking their attendance. Go ahead.
I will say that the vendors actually advocate for you guys in the field on your behalf. Because
right.
every once in a while, CDE will propose something and they will throw a fit about it.
Yes.
And say, absolutely, you can.
If any of you have ever met Cam Iliff, you know what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Okay?
I will say that they can be very vocal about the imposition that they're putting on the field.
Right. And Cam, if you ever watch this video, I'm sorry. But he knows what I'm talking about. Yeah, so previously it was sort of the vendor listserv, anybody could join that listserv. But what ended up happening is we started getting lots of districts that were joining the calls. And so they would always end up getting derailed with questions from districts. And so my manager made a decision that, no, you know, this is strictly a vendor call. Not that we don't want to engage districts, because we do, but we want to do that in other ways, in other forums.
Districts with customized systems.
Customized systems,
yeah.
Yes. But it has to be a district with one of those customized systems, which we actually keep track of. We know which districts operate custom systems. So LA Unified is one of those, right? So the rep from LA Unified would be there. So right now, yeah, it's only limited to vendors. And so we're trying to figure out other ways to engage LEAs, the SIM, you know, we do that twice a year, but apparently they're getting feedback from the field that that's not often enough. We need updates and proposed changes on a more frequent and regular basis. So CSIS and CDE are actually talking about that right now. So. Okay, so here are the roles, and they've changed pretty significantly, okay, for special education data. The CELPA director, their role previously when they were submitting, and you know exactly what your role was, right? You were responsible for consolidating all of the data for your district, your member districts, and you had to run it through the CASEMA software, and errors would be generated, and you would go back to your districts and say, you need to fix this, 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 and this. And the CELPA was primarily in charge for data submission and getting the districts to resolve their errors, right? So we have really changed that role. I mean, CELPA is a secondary reviewer in a lot of cases, especially when you have CELPAs that are huge with lots of members. We're shifting ownership back down to the districts, which means that there has to be an individual at the district that is a subject matter expert about special education data. There has to be. The problem is that this role really has not existed in most districts. And so I think that has been a struggle. Would you say that that's true?
I would definitely agree.
So how much assistance are you having to provide to your districts this year? Because they may not understand CALPADS data submission, certification, all of the errors that they're getting back, because that's traditionally a role that you've taken.
And I think that collaboration between the special ed data person and the CALPADS data accepted formally within district.
Right. Oh, yeah, and I would agree. I think everybody in this room would probably agree. But the business and the reporting requirements are going to change your business practices. And that's what we're actually really excited. I know you guys are probably not as excited about it, right? But we're really excited about it because it will force those changes. It will force you to have that collaboration. So the CELPA director's role has now changed. They're supposed to review the reports that the district has looked at, has corrected all of the errors. So you're submitting valid and reliable data. And then the CELPA is basically looking at it, giving it a second set of eyes and saying, I'm blessing this. Because they are required by law to certify those reports. The special education data coordinator is the person that works in the IEP system, is most knowledgeable about all of the business rules within special education. What we do not want to happen, particularly in large districts, is that they shift that responsibility, all these responsibilities in the second column, over to the CALPADS data administrator. We don't want that, okay? So if someone in your district is trying to shift those responsibilities to that person, it's probably not a good idea. Why is it not a good idea?
How can an overworked person?
Yes, overworked one. But those of you that work in special ed, well, you know.
That person doesn't necessarily understand the intricacies of the special ed.
No, not at all. It has taken me 5 years working with Shiloh, and I'm still about knee deep, right? I don't know all of the ins and outs and the IDEA laws and the timelines, and I don't know all of that stuff. So you cannot expect a CALPADS data administrator that works in the student information system that has never even, like, what does SAY stand for, right? They don't know that. So how can you expect that they're gonna take on those responsibilities? So this has been a huge obstacle, getting one person on the SPED side that's gonna act as that person. Yes. CALPADS? Oh, right, like qualities, like who the person should probably be. Well, I can tell you unequivocally that it has to be someone that works in the IEP systems every day. It has to. I'm not suggesting that that's the best person. I'm saying you have to build capacity. You either have to build capacity with an existing person. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I've given her the account, I've given her the role, but she hasn't done anything.
Right. So go ahead, Lisa.
So who did case miss reporting prior in your district?
Case miss. The CELPA? Who actually was responsible for the case miss reporting? Was it your CELPA director? The CELPA staff?
I don't have CELPA staff, but I know it.
So when CalPADS was implemented, there was the same issue. There wasn't anybody that was really designated to do that work. Somebody just kind of was either appointed or somebody stepped up or something like that happened, and you had to build the capacity within your district. Somebody has previously been doing the case miss work. Somebody's been submitting that data. They've got they've got those systems that they've been using. So maybe it's not the clerical staff that is appropriate, but maybe there's somebody in that department that's familiar with the data that was doing that before.
And she's a special ed director.
Well, then that might be her role as well.
Wow. There's no way she's gonna make up the extra role.
Well, so, but it's not that onerous.
You know, because it's coming to me.
But
it's coming to me. I don't mind, but I don't know anything about special ed.
Right.
You should.
But I'm helping with the errors because my special ed clerical doesn't know anything about CALPADS and doesn't know how to read an error report and doesn't even know how to sort out all of the problems.
But you didn't when you started either, right?
No, but I came ground up.
Exactly.
Right.
And so
right. Then you just answered your question.
You guys had that best practice cohort and gave notice to the.
Yes, thesis.
This is coming.
Right.
Really, I'm not kidding. You gave the district notice. This is coming. So we joined the best practices cohort, and we were given money to
so what
test
And what I'm hearing for you, from you is that PD is definitely needed,
yes.
Right? And so I hear you. We are in conversations with Shiloh's office about working with the CELPAs to provide professional development for these staff, because there is no extra money in a lot of cases, right? You have to work within the confines of your budget, but you may be able to build capacity within individuals. So that person that you says, I'm just a clerical. Most CALPADS administrators that I know started off as, I'm just the registrar, right? That's all I do. And now they know everything about discipline and chronic absenteeism, right? They're the experts. Did you have something?
I do have good news. In fact, I think CELPAs are recognizing it. I know that SCCOE has a CELPA department, and they, as late as last week, they probably filled a position, the CELPA data analyst.
Oh, that's great.
And I know that it's a brand new position, so a lot of questions about what is our role and all that came.
Right.
But this is exactly the position.
But this is something that we'll talk to Shiloh and the special education staff to see if we can get something going with the CELPA directors to see what we can do to help.
Yeah,
you know?
If some LEAs are doing it, just point, say, hey, maybe you won't have
best
that
practice.
Discussion.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. We used to get that request all the time for CALPADS.
Yep.
Okay. But what's really key is that those two individuals, if they happen to be two individuals, have to work together in order to get all of the data into CALPADS. The other change that we made was the responsibility of reporting data for students with disabilities, okay? So what we found when we looked at the case miss data and when we looked at your enrollment data, the entity that was reporting the special education data was not always the same place that where the student was going to school, right? And in order to get your data submitted into CALPADS, those two things have to be the same, right? The data that's reporting your special education IEP information and the district where they're enrolled, they have to be the same. So therefore, we said in CALPADS, now for all students, including students with disabilities, the reporting district is where they go to school. It's where they get the majority of their instruction, okay? Special education and related services can be provided by another district, but they would not be the reporting LEA, right? It is the district that provides the majority of services, and in this case, it's where the student goes to school. So there's lots of scenarios, and they actually sent out a listserv message with 21 different, have you seen it yet? Did you see the scenarios document? Okay, so what we tried to do was we tried to put together all of these scenarios for all different ages, preschool age, infant, all the way up to, you know, K-12. And what we're telling you is, in each of those instances, which of the districts is going to be responsible for reporting the data in CALPADS. And it has changed some things for particularly county offices of education. Okay, in CALPADS, county offices of education were creating what are called secondary enrollments and reporting the student as receiving services through the county office of education, through that program record, that 144 record. Okay, that's changed now. Because if they're only receiving speech, but they're going to school at Santa Clara Unified or San Jose Unified, San Jose Unified is responsible for reporting all of the data, including the information from SACE or CIRUS from their IEP, right? Because the county operates as a service provider only. So it sort of changed things. Make sure, if you haven't already, to take a look at that scenarios document if you have any questions about which district is responsible for reporting, and most importantly, which district is accountable. Because Jenny just told you in her last session that next year, all of those indicators are for students with disabilities are gonna roll back to the district of special education accountability, which means if they're getting suspended or they're chronically absent, it's gonna roll back to your district because you are responsible for their IEP. So take a look at the scenarios document in the listserv message. File dependencies. Everybody knows you have, well, maybe not, but this year you will know that you got to get an enrollment in for all students with disabilities. This has caused a lot of headaches because it's enrollments that you're not used to submitting. Private school students, infants, toddlers, right? Those are kids you generally don't create enrollments for. Why? Why don't you create enrollments for those kids? Well, you may not have it, but the other thing, the requirements, like all of the data needed for that. One of the reasons you don't create enrollments for them is because they're not enrolled. They're not actually going to school, right? So enrollment has changed for students with disabilities. What it really means is that your district now has a responsibility. Once you've obtained parental consent for that kid, parental consent for evaluation, the clock starts ticking. The district has 60 days to evaluate the student. Okay, therefore, you have to create an enrollment in CALPADS. And that clock, again, starts when the parent signs the parental consent for assessment. Okay, so before we were telling you, don't assign a statewide student identifier to these kids unless they were found eligible. That's not true now. Okay, they're gonna get an SSID. We're gonna know that they were referred and they have parental consent. And then whether or not you maintain that enrollment is dictated by whether or not the student actually is eligible and receiving services, okay? So the enrollment start date for these kids would be the parental consent date, and you have to maintain those enrollments just like you do every other enrollment in CALPADS unless they were determined ineligible for services, or they're eligible but the parent declines, or they're eligible and they're not going to receive services for any other reason. Okay, so those of you that work in SACE will kind of understand what I'm talking about. So, because oftentimes kids are found eligible, but the parent doesn't want the service, right? And if they don't, you don't have to maintain the enrollment. You can exit those enrollments with a no-show. Now, we did create a new enrollment status. There's been a lot of confusion about this new enrollment status. I can tell you that it's used for three groups of kids. Infants, toddlers, private school students. That's the status you're using for those groups of kids. You don't use it for preschool students. Under any circumstances, preschool kids should always be primary enrollments, and I'll tell you why in a minute. So private school kids, students on ISPs, you are going to be using the enrollment status 50. You're going to be enrolling them in a specific school. It's much like the NPS schools, but it's the 002 code, okay? So only private school kids get enrolled in that school. That's it. Infants and toddlers, one of the biggest questions we get asked is, these are little tiny babies, where do we enroll them? You know, we don't have a school. It's just, they're being served by the county. You can actually enroll them at the county level, or you can enroll them at the district level if you don't have a specific school code to put them in. Because it's really to obtain their SSID, to obtain their demographic information. You can enroll though, but you have to set up your district or your county as a school in your student information system. Okay. Let's see, what else did I want to say? So infants and toddlers, the young kids, we're not going to require birth country or parent ed level, okay, when you're obtaining an SSID for them. However, for all other ages, preschool and above, you must obtain all of the information necessary to create the enrollment. How do you do that with all your other kids? How do you obtain the information necessary for enrollment for all your other kids? Right, you register them with an enrollment packet, okay? Because now we're telling you, you have to sign parental consent. What should accompany that parental consent form? An enrollment packet, right? The parent should have to fill out the same enrollment packet. The next thing we get asked is, well, what documentation are you going to require for that? Your districts already have those policies in place, folks, right? They should have to provide the same documentation that are required for every other enrollment, even if they're only being evaluated for services. You are making the job of your CALPADS administrators much easier if you do that. 9 times out of 10, most districts don't do that, right? And that's why we see the discrepancies between the two systems, because they may not be requiring the same amount of information, right? But if you incorporate the enrollment process into your assessment process for special education, that's going to help significantly. Okay, so just things to think about. We are modifying one of the exit codes so that you can exit these enrollment status 50s every year. It's E170. So right now it's used for secondary enrollments, but now you can use that to exit your enrollment status 50s annually, right? So if they're eligible receiving services, you want to exit them at the end of the year, you would use E170. You should only no-show those enrollments if they never received services, period, okay? Do not, I've been getting these questions a lot lately. Are early TK kids we can use enrollment status 50 for those early TK kids, right? No. Why? Because they're kindergartners. They're primary enrollments, right? Even though they don't generate LCFF dollars or ADA, they do generate other things like they can be directly certified for free meals. They could be receiving homeless services. They could be receiving migrant services, Title III eligible immigrants, right? There are other reasons for that. So preschool kids should be primary. Transitional kindergarten kids should be primary. And then your adult age transition students on IEPs, they should also be primary. Okay, you should not use 50 for those. TKer who turns five in CALPADS is still a kindergartner. So early TK, so a lot of them were using preschool grade levels. They're not preschool, they're kindergartners. And because they're kindergartners, and you know why they were doing that primarily, it's because they didn't think they need to be LPAC tested. And they do, right? Early TK kids, it's a two-year kindergarten program. So in kindergarten, even if they're 4 years old, they need to be tested with the LPAC. All right, so the novella that we put out, otherwise known as Flash 161. Did you see it, Sujatha? She's like, oh, Lord, no. 13 pages this thing was. 13 pages, yeah, it was fun reading. So all of that information is in Flash 161, if you can't remember everything I'm saying. All right, so these are the two new files that are going to be required for Fall 1 for students with disabilities. Okay, they're coming directly from SACE or CIRUS. But we've also got other submissions that are going to have reports that are specific to students with disabilities. So end of year 3 and end of year 4 is a brand new one. Okay, these are going to require two levels of certification. So district level certification as well as SELPA level certification. But they don't call it certification. They call it approval. So you need two level approvals for all of those submissions. That's Fall 1, end of year 3, and end of year 4. Okay, we'll require two level approval. These are the file types. So the special education file, student services file, post-secondary status file, and starting next year, the test settings file. Okay, so the first, all of these will be coming directly from the IEP systems, right? Test settings is not going to be coming until 2020-21. And basically what this means is your IEP systems are going to send accommodations and designated supports for students with IEPs directly to CALPADS, and then CALPADS will send it over to TOMS. Okay, this year, it's status quo. You actually have to take those accommodations and designated supports out of your IEP systems and upload them to TOMS. How many of you are having problems getting those in right now? Anybody that you're aware of? You will. You'll have problems. Because in order to get those accommodations and designated supports in to TOMS, you have to have a record that identifies them as a student with disabilities. And they're still trying to get those data in there, right? So if you have to test kids, you need to make sure that that record is in CALPADS first. So next year, it shouldn't be as much of an issue because those two files will be dependent on one another. You could not submit test settings for a kid that does not have a special education record already, right? Yes?
And can't do the SPED unless they have a testing on.
Yes, right? There's all these dependencies. So now the SIS coordinator has to work with the special education data coordinator who has to work with the assessment coordinator. Right? It's going to be one big kumbaya party, y'all. Okay? Yes.
Initial
LPACs are still, uploading the scores into the local scoring tool, it is not an online assessment yet. It's still paper pencil, but here's what I figured out in the last week. So we thought, well, this is not a big deal, right? So it's the initial, it's a paper pencil test. So they can provide the accommodations and supports even if it's not in CALPADS or if the student hasn't been identified as SPED. The problem is that in order for the tester to actually go into TOMS to provide the listening portion and provide accommodations to students with disabilities, that student has to be flagged as SPED. Even though it's a paper pencil test, there's like one accommodation that has to be provided through TOMS, and that will only happen if the student's been identified as a student with disabilities. So yeah, that's a problem. We haven't figured out the answer yet, okay. But yeah. Yes?
I have one question.
Sure.
This is something that during our focus groups also I used to talk about this. These four types of files, are they acceptable by the CIS people so that they can absorb this data at varying different frequencies? Because, I mean, I've had cases where, for example, you know, for example, a local data warehouse situation like what we have developed, right? The SSRP file is important, like how many students are getting speech or, you know. So once we are able to take this file from the IEP management system to the SIS, it could be put to good local use.
Potentially.
We're still getting this cases uploads.
Yeah, but so that, but what I'm saying is these are, it's increasing.
Yeah, oh yeah,
yeah, absolutely.
So some of the vendors, I know Aries specifically has built in all of the new SPED fields, whether it's easily transferable. Unfortunately, SACE and Aries don't play together very nice, right? So whether or not those data are moving into Aries regularly, but I have heard from some districts that have said what they're planning on doing is actually just taking a ODS extract from CALPADS and pushing it into Aries, right, manually. So, but it's a good idea. I mean, if you can think of local uses and you can get your vendors to buy into that, they'll add import tools for you. Because, yeah, I think it would be valuable information.
Imagine a COE saying something versus CDE saying, play nice. That's what I think.
Oh, Lord, if it were that easy, Sujatha. Okay, yeah, because it's not, unfortunately. All right. So there is a specific order that we want you to submit these files in. Obviously, the student enrollment file is first. You got to get that in there. Then they can get the SPED record in there and the services record. And it is not dependent. Getting that SPED record in there is not dependent on getting the student profile information in, right? And what I mean is their demographics, their race, ethnicity, their birth date, all of that stuff, what programs they're in, whether or not they're an English learner. There isn't any dependency on getting these two files in on those file types. But what I can tell you is the number one reason kids are not showing up in reports, if you're reviewing those special education reports, is because the profile information isn't there. Right? Remember, those reports disaggregate kids by grade level and primary disability and race, ethnicity, and gender. So if the profile information isn't in there, the reports cannot generate those reports. So they just don't put the kid in there. So you have to have a full profile of information in order for your special education staff to see the student on the report. It's really important from the SIS side that you get all of that information in there, and this is the suggested order. All of the demographic and enrollment data for every single report in CALPADS, every single one, is coming from data from your student information system. And that includes the reports for students with disabilities. So no longer are we using the information from SACE or CIRUS. Okay? So this integration piece between your two systems is absolutely key. It has to tell the same story about the same student. And whatever that looks like in your district, it could be automated integration. It could be people talking to each other, just a local process. But what ends up happening is SACE will send up a record, and your SIS will send up a record. CALPADS is going to use whatever comes from your student information system. So you have to make sure whatever is in your SIS is right. We're not telling you that that's the authoritative source. We're just telling you that that's what we're going to use. Okay? We have provided a discrepancy extract. Has anybody used this yet? How do you, do you like it?
I'm fine with it. Again, it's training the rest of my team.
Right, right, on how to use it. Okay. So this will tell you differences between the SPED file and the student enrollment and student information files. We're giving you information that tells you that your two systems are not speaking the same language, right? Whether you choose to use it is a local issue, but you should. You should reconcile those two things because we're providing you this in an extract. So really encourage your districts to use it, okay? Downloading the discrepancy extract, so the Excel template for this. So when you get this extract, it doesn't look like this. It's actually really awful and messy. It's a text file. But if you download this template, you can just import the information into the template. CSIS put this together, and it has been a godsend for lots of districts, right? So make sure you do that. Go into CALPADS in the extract section and look for the SPED discrepancy extract, because it'll tell you where a lot of your errors are. All right, these are all the fields that need to be consistent between those two systems. You can tell I'm going fast because we're almost out of time, and of course I'm talking too much. So we're already past Census Day, so everybody in here is familiar with Census Day, but what we do know is that the special education community kind of flipped out because they thought, oh my God, CALPADS is taking the picture on October 2nd, and we can't get any data into the system. And those of you that have been working in CALPADS a long time know that that's not true, right? You keep submitting data. CALPADS looks at your data based on the meeting dates and pulls the kids that were eligible and receiving services on information day on October 2nd. We want you to get LEA level approval. We want you to look at all of the data for fall 1 and say, yes, we agree with this by December 6th. It's not a hard deadline, but this is December 20th. You need to get that initial certification done, which means both levels have to approve. Your LEA level has to approve, and your SELPA has to approve. Okay. Then you have a 3-week window, if you so choose, to unapprove your submission, make corrections, and then send it back through that approval process. Okay, it's 3 weeks, all the way till January 24th. That's the deadline. Snapshot. It's students eligible and receiving services on the first Wednesday in October, and they have to be on an IEP, IFSP, or ISP. And then we're also collecting pending students, so kids that were pending evaluation on Information Day. Okay, so as I told you, that's all of the data. The student information system person is responsible for everything in green. Special education person is responsible for everything in purple, but it is one collective submission, one. Okay, so you have to hit that approval button jointly. Then once it goes to SELPA, SELPA takes a look at those reports, says, I approve, and then you are certified. There is no certify button in CALPADS anymore. Okay, it's two approvals, one certification. SELPA has the option to disapprove it. Okay, so you cannot be certified until the SELPA actually approves those special education reports within your Fall 1 submission. It's really important that you talk to each other. Jenny covered this, but remember that all of your results for students with disabilities in the academic indicator in the Fall dashboard are being attributed to the District of Special Education Accountability. And then next year, all of the indicators, chronic absenteeism, suspension, are going to roll back to the District of Special Education Accountability. Okay, so data for students with disabilities in TOMS. This is what it is now. You have to get a SPED record successfully posted in CALPADS that then gets sent over to TOMS, which takes 24 to 48 hours, in order to provide accommodations and supports in any of the online assessments. And now apparently for the LPAC, because there's that listening portion that has to be done by the person administering the test. So you need to work with your SPED coordinators to make sure, prioritize kids that are taking the alternate assessments. Right? The department has been saying, please test them early as you possibly can. The problem is, if the CALPADS coordinator and the special education data coordinator aren't able to get that record in there for them, it's going to be a problem, right? So you need to prioritize those kids, getting those records posted in CALPADS for those kids so you can provide designated supports and accommodations. All of these are issues that we're currently having. Okay, so if any of your SPED coordinators are coming to you and saying, I'm getting this error, and I don't know how to fix it, don't do anything, because they're bugs, right? We're fixing all of these things. So if you're getting any of these errors that they're asking about, just wait until we fix it, because it's going to be more headache than it's worth. Okay?
Has that gone out in a flash at all, like this?
Oh, my gosh. I can't remember. I haven't been in the office in 2 weeks. I don't think it was in the SIM, but we did say that we needed to send a communication out. Yeah, so you're right. Okay, I'll talk to Shiloh about that when we get back. All right, so reporting changes. Everybody knows assignment monitoring's coming. Okay, so fall two, because I know you guys are super excited, jazzed about fall two this year. These are all new elements that we added to CALPADS, the course section record. And they're all, almost all of them are going to be used for assignment monitoring. But here's the good news. Good news is it's inconsequential. They're not going to do anything to you if the data are crap. Okay?
For
this year, right? Next year, it does matter, right? But all of these new data elements need to be populated for fall two. We did a really extensive training. There is a webinar that is available still on our website if you're really interested in hearing it again. But it will tell you all about assignment monitoring and what each of these data elements are being used for. These should already be in your student information systems, right? But you as data people should not be making decisions about these. It's your curriculum and instruction folks. It's your human resources, your credential analysts. They should assist in the population of this because there's no way you could know all of this stuff, right? And these should, like I said, should already be in your student information systems. This is a new change. We got lots of feedback on this in the SIM. Who do you report in the course section record? Which teacher gets associated with a course, and which teacher is going to be on the hook for being appropriately assigned? So we worked with CTC, and CTC says now, this is a significant departure, that it's the teacher of record. Does not matter if the teacher is not going to be there all year, if they are on maternity leave for an entire year. If they are the teacher of record, that is the teacher that goes in the course record, period. There's no October 31st rule, nothing. If there is no teacher of record, meaning if there is a vacancy, you would report the seed of the substitute teacher, and vacancies are always misassignments, always. Everybody clear about that? Teacher of record.
Right.
Yeah.
The prop would serve the community well if you put scenarios for that. Because I know it's simple, but, you know, we have year after year, we have different scenarios, different questions.
Right. Tipsels, pips, stips, that kind of thing. Right.
So,
yes, you're right. It's a Q&A coming soon when Brandy gets back to the office. Okay. So, again, a vacancy is always a misassignment. It's not a bad thing. It's just a vacancy. You're having trouble filling the slot. And this next year, it's okay. They're not going to ding you for it anyway. All right. We're over time here. Okay. I'm going to let you go. But I am happy to stay after and discuss discipline or the English learner programs, the language instruction programs, with anybody that would like to stay. If you don't, and you're ready to get out there and into the traffic, I will not take offense to it, believe me. But thank you for being so attentive. I just tend to talk a lot. Does anybody have any questions before we go?
I'm not.
All right. And like I said, yes.
So as a COE, if we control the IEP, but the student is mainstream out of district,
who reports the data, their special education data? The district where they're mainstreamed, right? So the COE is a service provider, but they're not providing the majority of instruction, right? So that district is responsible for not only reporting all of their enrollment and student profile information, but now they will have to be the entity that sends that record up from SACE. Yeah. And in SACE, both of those entities actually have access to the student records. Right, so both the district of service and the district of special ed accountability have access to those records in SACE.
So our usual scenario.
Thank you.
What about 504 records? Is that any different? I remember year after year, sometime in April we have 504 program issues.
So the 504 program is still in CALPADS, right? And you actually need a 504 record if that student needs accommodations or designated supports in TOMS. So how are those going to, are you talking about the changes that are coming in 2021?
I'm just talking about, you know how the test setting changes?
Yeah.
SDSD.
Yeah.
Or whatever the last one.
Right. Good question.
504 mm-hmm. would also have accommodations.
Yeah.
I know that because.
So the SIS vendors are also going to use that file, that same file format, right? But for students on 504 plans and general ed students who need designated supports, because you can assign designated supports for those students, that file will have to come from the student information system vendors as well, but only usually for 504 kids or general ed kids. Special ed kids, that same file format will be coming up for students on IEPs. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Sure.
Since I'm in Head Start now, we service preschool kids at our center, but I don't think you guys have the information in your SIS. So how would that work?
There's some overlap, I found. But yeah, generally, we don't have your Head Start kids.
Yes. Are they students with disabilities?
They are. And okay. Some of them are. Most of them are from, other school districts.
Right.
That they can provide service for. So we are providing service for these kids.
Yeah. Your district is providing services.
Check that
for
because there is some overlap. Yeah. So it may be that we've got your special ed. Mm-hmm.
So Head Start has been, I probably have read 30 different tickets on Head Start kids in the last, I think we need to provide some better guidance. Those scenarios that I told you went out, in the listserv, and they're also kind of an addendum to Flash 161.
Yeah.
They actually have different scenarios for Head Start kids. So look through those and see whether or not it fits. Because in some scenarios, your district would be reporting them because that's where they're going to school. That's where they're receiving the majority of instruction is through the Head Start program, right? And it's not the COE in that case.
Right. I'll send you that.
Because some of these kids, like your parents, like, oh, I didn't have time to, get these kids graduated.
Right.
So they come to, Head Start. And then we realize these kids need an IEP.
Right.
So they're getting evaluated. Then they're determined that they're IEP kids.
Right.
So, it's,
so it sounds like your district probably has the reporting responsibility. If the COE is providing the special ed services, mm-hmm. but you are providing the majority of instruction, mm-hmm. it's very likely you guys should be reporting those records. But, look, she's looking at me like, what? Wait a minute. But, like I said, look through the scenarios document. If you don't find one that fits, then send in a ticket, and then we'll have to have some further discussion about it, because I'm telling you, the Head Start tickets have started to roll in.
Is this presentation available somewhere?
Yes, it is available.
Irina is sending out a survey to see how everybody liked things. In that survey, there'll be all of the
links to the PowerPoint.
The
instructions, yeah. All of the access to PowerPoints.
Oh, great.
For all of the
yes.
Any of the sessions that you went to didn't go to access.
Okay, perfect. Okay, well, thank you very much. And I will stay behind for questions if you've got it. Sorry. I knew I wasn't going to get through all these slides. Anyway.